Hello everyone and welcome back to Computer Vision lecture series. This is lecture 7, part 3. In this lecture we are going to continue talking about solutions to model fitting for inliers and outliers. We are specifically going to look into hue transforms and ransacks. But before we go there, let's talk about our original stereo problem. When you have two image stereo pairs, how can we know which are the good correspondences or which of the matches that you generated are the good ones? Is there a way to know apart from visually? Because visually it takes time, and if you have hundreds and millions of images, it's not efficient. So how do you choose which are the good matches? We need to find out some quantitative measure based on the algorithms or the methods that we use. Maybe some parameterizations, some constraints that we can impose that can generate for us good matches. For example, with linear least squares, when we use linear least squares to fit a set of points using a line, for example, in this case, you see the least squares is able to fit all the points in all the red points here. So it's a good fit. However, it is not robust to noise. If there is an outlier, the linear least squares fit is not able to penalize the outlier in a lower with low values. It generates as big an error, and using those big errors, the model is fitted, and because of that, the shape of the original shape is changed, and it is not really a good fit. So there is another solution to the linear least squares, which is called robust least squares, which is therefore dealing with the outliers. In this, there is a general approach where we minimize a function, robust function rho, with a scale parameter sigma. In this case, in the linear least squares case, the errors that were this is a map or the graph of the error or the penalty that is imposed on the fitting algorithm. Instead of using this parabolic or exponentially increasing error curve, we flatten the error curve above a certain limit. So if the penalty is higher than a certain limit, then the function will apply a constant penalty for larger errors or residuals in this case. The scale sigma can be chosen using adaptive measures, but this kind of robust function fitting helps linear least squares to deal with some outliers. So we also need to, the effect of the outlier is minimized if we use the robust linear least squares measure. However, if the scale parameter is not chosen properly, then the model fitting is again not very good. So if there is a higher or too large or too small value of the scale that is being chosen, then the fit is quite poor, and it behaves more or less like the linear least squares. Robust estimation is basically a non-linear parameter optimization problem that can be solved iteratively, that we have seen using linear least squares. And scale is a scale of such function should be chosen appropriately, and we can choose them adaptively using based on some median residuals and things like that. So you calculate all the error matrices, error values, and then you choose the median values of that, and then you can choose an appropriate scale. But this is like a hack, or it's like a scarce or a rough, very rough approximation to fitting robust functions. However, this kind of methods apply a good initialization for more sophisticated iterative methods. So fitting and alignment methods that we have seen so far, basically which search the global space for the optimal parameters, linear least squares and robust least squares that we have seen. And there is another method called iterative closest point, which we are not covering in this series. And then there is another set of methods which propose some hypotheses, and then we test those hypotheses on those model parameters or the model fits, and then we do an iterative or number of different runs to choose the best possible model fit for the parameter. So sorry, the best possible parameters for the model fit. In this case, there are methods like U transforms and RANSAC. So we begin with Hue's transforms. Hue transform is basically estimating parameters for through a voting procedure. What is usually done, like let's say for example we are fitting a line or you are doing an edge detection algorithm on a certain image. The edge detection algorithm, maybe you use a Kenny edge detector or any other state of the art. Maybe there is a line and the edges are not continuously being shown on that line. Maybe the algorithm misses some points or some regions between the lines. However, visually when you see, you realize that those points are actually belonging to the edges. In such cases, Hue transform can help. However, the search space for Hue transform is quite heavy and computationally very expensive. Anyways, what is done is, let's say this is the line or the edge in the example that we discussed, and there is a which is represented in a normal parameterization form as x cos theta plus y sin theta equals to rho. Rho is the perpendicular distance of this line to from the origin, and theta is the angle of that perpendicular. And in the parameter space of theta and rho, this line will have a single point. So let's say there is a, instead of in the x direction it is rho, and in the y direction it is theta, this line can be represented by a small point there. And so a points in one picture can be so this example that I gave was for the space where you replace x-axis and y-axis with rho and theta. But if you are if you have the value, if you look into the actual parameter space of theta, the points in this picture basically can be represented as sinusoid in those parameter space. Similarly, points in parameter space can be represented as lines in our picture. So what happens is, here we represent in this theta and rho space these different points, and different sinusoids represent these points. And if all these points lie all these points lie on the same line, and then in the parameter space it will be closer to one point, or they will overlap or intersect. Let's say you have another line here which is crossing this. Basically you are another model fit for your measurements. Then there will be a different sinusoid and it will intersect at different points. And using this method, you can find the best fit of rho and theta for your fit. And then that using those parameters, you can reconstruct your original line or the edge in our original example. That's basically what a Hue transform does. So sinusoids corresponding to collinear points in one image will intersect at a unique point. It is obvious because when we see the parameterization of the line using this function, it means that these theta and rho parameter can be estimated if they intersect in the in the parameter space. The problem here increases if there are more number of points or more number of parameters to estimate. In this case, there are just two axes with theta and rho parameters, but let's say we add another parameter, then the number of combinations and the search space increases exponentially for every additional parameter added. So the computation of finding this right parameter fit for our model is quite expensive for Hue transform. So we look into RANSAC algorithm. RANSAC algorithm is also something similar in terms of finding the best fit or the best inliers for the model that you have proposed. So you theorize a model. Let's say you want to fit a line or you want to fit a quadratic plane, and then you iterate your algorithm over all the available points, and if it able and you ransack is a method to find a consensus of all these proposals, and the one which has the highest consensus will be considered the best fit. So let's say this is your measurements that you have taken, and that's all you have, right? And you have to work with this measurements, and you start with fitting one a good fit, like a line that passes through a lot of points using, let's say, linear least squares, right? The problem is that these points will be left out, and it's not a good fit. And it might produce a wrong result because of a lot of outliers being present here. So what does ransack do? Ransack has three main steps. First, you sample the points, the number of points as much is required to fit the model. So if you're fitting a line, you need at least 2 points. If you're fitting a curve, like a quadratic curve or something, you need 3 or more points accordingly. So depending on the kind of model that you have chosen to fit the data, you choose the number of sample points to start with, and then you solve for those model parameters, and then you using those samples, and then you so let's say you are fitting a line here. If you are choosing these 2 points, then you fit the line across these 2 points, and then you solve for these model parameters using other samples, and you find out which other samples lie close to your fit. In this case, theta represents the tolerance or the threshold value that you use for your model fit. And if you fix the theta value and find out how many points lie inside or close to your model fit, those points, in this case, you have added, by fitting these 2 points, you have added 4 more inliers. So in total, you have 6 points that are a good fit for the model that you have proposed here. Your model is this line. But as we can see that it's not really a good fit. So what you do is you try to score by the fraction or the number of inliers that you have using the threshold that you have chosen. And then you repeat again this same method by choosing two randomly choosing another 2 points, right? So let's say you choose these 2 points. In this case, there are 14 inliers, and this seems to be a better fit for your algorithm than the other than this previous one, right? So in this fitting, remember that you have just chosen these 2 points to fit the whole line, and therefore the influence of these outliers is not visible in this fitting. If you had used linear least squares, let's say for example for fitting this, you would have considered the distances of these outliers as well in fitting the line or finding the proper slope and intercept of this line for the fitting. Whereas in case of ransack, you start with the minimum number of samples that required, and then you iterate over to find the fraction of inliers that follow or are very close according to a given threshold that you have chosen for the model, and therefore it's a better fit or a better algorithm for line fitting. And you repeat this all these three steps until you find the best model with a very high confidence. High confidence can be calculated using lower value of threshold and high, given lower value of threshold, if you're able to detect or have more number of inliers, then that's a better or a good fit, right? So there are a few parameters that you need to choose for ransack to work, right? Beginning with the number of iterations. So why is this important? How many iterations you have to do? Let's say you have 1,000 number of data points, and you want to fit a model in that, right? You don't want to choose just 10 random points and try to fit a line across it, because there are 990 more points out there which you have to find how many of them are inliers to your algorithm, and therefore the higher number of iteration, the better fit you will be able to find. And using this error values of the distances of your inliers to the outliers, you can choose how many iterations you want to do, which has a very high score or a high probability rate for your outlier ratio. So if your outliers are too few, then it's a good fit for that particular number of iterations. Essentially, what you say is that you choose the number of you choose n such that the probability that at least one random sample is free from the outlier, and this is how you choose the number of iterations, which is very important. As I explained, if you have more data points, or if you increase the data points from 1,000 to 10,000 to millions, then this number of iterations will be very important. Second is the number of sample points to be chosen. Let's say you are fitting a line, then you need to choose two. If you are fitting a quadratic curve, three, four, polynomial curves, and so on and so forth. So it depends on the kind of model that you want to fit. And depending on the kind of model, you have to choose the number of sample points to fit the model. And then there is the distance threshold. By fitting the model, by choosing a particular sample points, then you have to choose such a threshold that a good point will with noise will likely be your inlier, and all the others will be outliers. And that is how you have to work with choosing the parameters. It's not so easy to work with this kind of parameters, because RANSAC does not give you too much freedom in choosing this. I mean, let's say for threshold, what more can you do in that, right? You have seen in exercise 2, you have experienced it while coding, that if you increase a little bit of those values in positive or negative directions, your number of matches will increase or decrease accordingly. And there is not much you can do here. There is no more parameterization or more sophisticated measures that you can include to improve the RANSAC algorithm. Similarly, the number of sample points, yes. In that case, you can increase, let's say your model fits better with a polynomial of degree 5 than a polynomial of degree 3, that you can use, but it's also a heuristic or empirical choice, the one that works best for you. And it's the search space is huge. Which degree of polynomial you have to choose, that search space is quite huge, and because of that, it's not easy to choose the number of sample points as well. So there are a lot of restrictions in case of for using the RANSAC algorithm. Okay, let's try to solve translation using RANSAC algorithm. You have some few points in two different images, and you want to fit, in this case, points B and B5 will be outliers. It is not easy to solve translation, because when you choose two random points, always there will be two other points or other points which are lying outside, because translation is a rigid body transformation, and therefore it preserves the shape, size, and everything of the object, and therefore it's not easy to fit using a RANSAC solution. There will always be outliers in case of translation. Another example is that of finding matches, correspondence matches. So VLFIT is an algorithm which finds this like a sift, where you find this correspondence, feature correspondence across different images taken from different viewpoints and things like that. And you find among a lot of hundreds or thousands of local features, let's say you find a few hundred matches. But this is a mess, this is very noisy, and it's not easy to see which is a right match, right? There could be a lot of confident matches. In such cases, epipolar lines are quite helpful. You choose the epipolar lines for a particular point in one image, and then you just keep the matches which are the best inliers using the RANSAC algorithm. And therefore, the fundamental matrix in conjunction with the RANSAC will give you a very good inlier fit for your correspondence problem. And you are essentially solving a stereo matching problem as well in this, not in this case, but it also works for the stereo matching. So what are the conclusions? What are the major pros for RANSAC? RANSAC, we have seen, it is quite robust to outliers. You are not considering the error or the distances of outliers to fit your model, and therefore your model is agnostic to the position or the distance of those outliers. So it's a good thing. It's also applicable to large number of objective function parameters, even if your model fit or the parameters that you use for fitting the model is higher. It uses the similar objective functions for finding the inliers and the outliers, whereas in case of U transform, by adding one more parameter, you are increasing exponentially the search space, and therefore U transform is more computationally expensive than RANSAC. However, the large RANSAC is better even if you increase the number of parameters for fitting your model. Similarly, for RANSAC, the choosing the optimization parameters is easier. The distance metric to choose is quite simple. If you have a bigger curve, maybe you don't use Euclidean distances to find the inliers and outliers. Maybe use a bit more sophisticated measures like Dice coefficients or maybe Hausdorff distances that are better measures to find distances between two unrestricted curves. So maybe RANSAC gives you freedom in choosing this kind of optimization parameters, whereas with case of U transforms, it's not easy. But it is easy for U transform to find this threshold values. So let's say you have so in case of RANSAC, the computational time grows quickly with the number of parameters, so on and so forth. We already know this, but it's not. It is still better than U transform. The drawback or the biggest con of RANSAC is it's not good for getting multiple fits, right? So let's say you are you have chosen a particular threshold and you have fixed your model parameters, and then you can only get one fit. You cannot have multiple solutions to that. Yes, you can change the threshold value to get a better fit or things like that, but that is only one fit, right? You cannot say that this is using that values, you cannot say I have this second best fit. So it's not easy to choose, and it's ugly because it's empirical and you have to do a lot of more iterations for that. Whereas in case of U transform, for example, when you map all those points in the line in the parameter space of rho and theta, you will have some region where those points intersect, and you can fix some region around that point to say that, hey, this is my first best fit, and then you can find in the other regions which is the second best fit. So let's say in the first region there are 100 intersecting curves, and then you fix that as your first best fit, and then you look at the second intersection region where you have maybe 50 or 60 intersecting curves, and then you can suggest that that's a second best fit. It's also not so good, but it is a bit better than RANSAC. It gives you space, or it gives you freedom to choose another fit for your algorithm. And the main common applications, as we have already seen for RANSAC, is estimating fundamental metrics relating to two views, as well as computing homography, like in image stitching. And you have already seen this in exercise 3. And I hope with this video, you will be able to solve easily your exercise 3. I think I have covered all the concepts measured in exercise 3, and you should not have any problems. It's quite easy now. Once you attend or watch all these lectures and go back to exercise 3, it is quite simple and straightforward to solve them. So, until next time, thank you.